This year, this election year, the Supreme Court will decide whether Obamacare is constitutional or not. Will the court help re-elect President Obama? Here today, constitutional scholars Richard Epstein and John Yoo. They'll talk about Obamacare and they'll talk dirty politics. Uncommon Knowledge now. Welcome to Uncommon Knowledge. I'm Peter Robinson. By the way, please visit us on our website, hoover.org/UK. Joining me, two of the nation's leading constitutional scholars, a professor at the New York University School of Law and a fellow at the Hoover Institution. Richard Epstein is the author, most recently, the author of a cascade of books and articles, but most recently, Design for Liberty, Private Property, Public Administration, and the Rule of Law. A professor at the law school at the University of California at Berkeley and a former member of the Justice Department during the administration of George W. Bush, John Yoo's most recent book is Confronting Terror, 9/11 and the Future of American National Security. Richard and John, welcome.
It's great to be here.
Thanks. In a word, and this for this very first question, just one word, will the court help to reelect President Obama, John?
Oh, that's great. Yes.
Richard?
Well, probably.
That was two.
Okay. Yeah, but for Richard, that's miraculous in itself. Segment one, the Supreme Court and the individual mandate. Passed in the House and Senate without a single Republican vote and signed into law by President Barack Obama on March 23rd, 2010, the Patient Protection and Affordable Care Act, universally known as Obamacare, raises a couple of constitutional issues. Issue one. The issue we'll talk about first, the constitutionality of the individual mandate. May the federal government force individuals to purchase health insurance? John, what should the plaintiffs argue?
Plaintiffs should essentially say the federal government doesn't have power under the Constitution to compel people to enter the marketplace. Until this point in constitutional history, what would happen is that the market would produce a product, a good or service. People would voluntarily enter the market to sell goods or buy them. Once they're in that interstate market, then basically since the New Deal, the courts have allowed Congress a relatively free hand in regulating that commerce. What's unprecedented about Obamacare is that if you're a 25-year-old kid in good health and you just want to sit on your couch and play video games and you don't want to buy health insurance, this federal law forces you to. Either you have to buy insurance or you're fined when you haven't done anything. You're just passive. That's a new and unprecedented thing. What the plaintiff's second argument should be is, what's the stopping point? If the government can make you do things that it feels are good for you, then why not tell you to buy a car? Why not tell you which kind of house? Why not tell you you have to exercise? Why not tell you what kind of foods you have to eat or can't eat? There doesn't seem to be any stopping point to the theory of the size of government once you allow, under Obamacare, the government to start ordering you to buy health care or do A, B, and C.
But, Richard, draw the lines for me, for this layman. The government may compel the young person in perfect health to join the armed forces and go off to fight. The draft is perfectly constitutional. The government may compel that young person in perfect health or this older person in so-so health to sit on a jury.
You got it.
I may be compelled to do those two things. Why may the government not compel that person to buy health insurance?
Well, what you have to do to understand this argument is to ask what's the rationale that are given behind these two situations. And essentially, the basic position is that military defense and jury duty are parts of the duties of citizenship that everybody else has. When you start coming to the situation with respect to the mandate, the way the argument starts to break down is we have to force you in there because of all sorts of economic reasons that bear nothing with your public duties. And the two arguments are somewhat inconsistent. One of them says, well, well, we have to make you get insurance because otherwise you'll freeload on the emergency room. But of course, what you could tell them is you can't come to the emergency rooms unless you get yourself insurance. And if you're 25 years of age, it's relatively cheap to get unless you have to subsidize everybody else. So the second argument is we have to drag you in order to subsidize older people who cannot afford to pay the market rate for the very rich set of benefits that they want. And I think that the third piece, therefore, of the defense, at least within conventional terms, of the attack, is to indicate that these two rationales that are put forward for the bill by its defendants are, in fact, mutually inconsistent and highly suspect, each in its own right. The correct answer is, if people don't want to get health care, that's their choice. They have to take the risk. And if you wish to have a subsidy program, you don't want to put all that burden on the young and the healthy. What you want to do is make it part of general revenues. And we know that when they try to get this thing through as a tax bill, there was so much resistance that they abandoned the effort.
Which article of the Constitution prohibits the federal government from engaging in an individual mandate?
Well, it's not a question of which one forbids it. You got the question upside down. Yeah. The question is which one authorizes it.
Right. The structure of the Constitution.
Is that the way the justices will reason?
Well, this is, we don't know. But the answer is that's the argument.
That's the way you should argue.
And in fact, it's consistent with the text in history.
At least three of them will find that way.
Yeah,
There'll be at least three justices think that way clearly.
Clarence Thomas, Antonin Scalia, and Samuel Alito.
Alito, I would say.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then you have Kennedy and Roberts. Now, the thing is, Justice Kennedy, who's always that justice in the middle since Justice O'Connor's left. Before Justice O'Connor left, he actually was a pretty vigorous proponent of maintaining a balance between the federal government and the state governments. On the other hand, he doesn't like to do very unpopular things. He likes this position in the middle of the court. I think that places him in some doubt in a way it didn't maybe 10 years ago.
You mentioned state balance between the federal government and the state government. It's in the air. Romney Care. If it is impermissible for the federal government to enforce an individual mandate, is it permissible for the state, the Commonwealth of Massachusetts?
Let me return to what Richard was just said, is that it's kind of upside down. And in a way, Peter, all the Obama administration arguments have already seeped into your mind, even though you didn't know it. Because
I'm gone. It's happened.
You're lost.
I've been brainwashed.
You're a lost soul. So the Constitution, right, its very structure is a limited government. And for the federal government to do anything, you have to find an affirmative grant of power from the people. But notice the way you asked it is, where in the Constitution does it say we can't do it?
Right.
This is liberalism. Like, we assume the government can do it unless something in the Constitution says you can't. That is actually the Constitution upside down.
I'm simply giving voice to Speaker Pelosi, former Speaker Pelosi.
Look,
for the Commonwealth, in other words, Mitt Romney has the argument right. That is to say, what we did in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts is our business and has no bearing on the larger constitutional question.
He's half right and half wrong.
I think Richard and I disagree with this.
I think that there's a kind of complication. Look, the first point is things are authorized, meaning powers, and then things prohibited, which are Bill of Rights protection. One of the arguments that you would make against Romney Care as a state matter is, why is it consistent with our notion of individual liberty for the state to say, anybody to say under its police powers, you have to subsidize somebody else through health care? And so that would be the individual autonomy argument as opposed to the Commerce Clause argument. And the truth of the matter is, actually, it sounds easier to most people, because if they're worried about the things that John talked about, dragooning, why would it be so wonderful for a state government to say for somebody who wants to sit home and watch sports and eat potato chips, that you have to subsidize everybody else? But what is interesting is federalism arguments seem to resonate to this court. Individual liberty arguments do not. So the whole individual liberty argument is done through the
Commerce Clause. If all nine seats became vacant at once, and we named you to the court.
God help us.
The individual liberty argument would resonate with you.
Well, they both resonate with me. Look, one of the things I just mentioned briefly, and I think John knows this, is that the entire New Deal structure of the Commerce Clause, which says that if you feed your grain to your cows, you're engaged in interstate commerce, is a complete perversion of the original organization, which said that the Commerce Clause went to deal with cross-border transactions.
Right.
So the Epstein Hughes Supreme Court would try to get back to the earlier reading on both the Commerce Clause, which means narrow it, and the individual liberty rights, which would mean to broaden it, which means that we get at this point, zero votes in the Senate?
But I would say that if there were nine Richard Epsteins on the court, it would still break out 5-4 on a lot of issues.
Actually, I'm a man of two minds, but not on many issues.
On the individual mandate, only on that issue, how will the court rule?
That's tough. I think there's four certain votes to uphold it. the four Democrat appointed justices. There's no wavering, no indication at all that they would break ranks on this. So what you have to do is the other five, and I think you have Thomas is for certain the most. He's already pretty much said in his early opinions anything like Obamacare would be unconstitutional. And I think you have Alito, and I think you have Scalia, although some people doubt maybe that Scalia would go this way because Larry Silberman, for whom I clerked, upheld the Obamacare statute in the lower court.
What on earth?
And well, many people think, which I think is true, that Silberman and Scalia see a lot of issues very similarly. I still think Scalia won't jump ship on this. So then it's really up
Chief
to Kennedy.
Justice, the Chief Justice.
I think Roberts, if Kennedy's going to go and strike it down, I think Roberts
would go
too.
But he won't go alone.
If Kennedy upheld the law, I could see Roberts going with the majority to control who got to write the opinion and try to keep it as narrow as possible, because Roberts cares about the institutional permanence of the court and protecting it from politics.
Yeah, but I mean, the vulnerability here, quite simply, is this. There have been a number of conservative judges who've defected to the it's okay view, and there have been no
including
Silberman.
And his opinion, he's a lower court judge. He says previous opinions are so broad in what Congress is allowed to do,
I can only defer to the President
and the Supreme Court.
No,
he said to the Supreme Court of 1938.
Yeah, you guys, if they're going to, somebody's going to have to pull the bomb or to get the pin out of the grenade. It's going to have to be the Supreme Court. Yeah. But the way the opinion reads, there's too much relish in the decision that he takes. And so it's not a very well-reasoned opinion.
In the Silberman
opinion. Mm. I actually wrote something which indicated that I thought that this was not reluctant duty, but as sort of an unseemly enthusiasm with respect to what I think is intellectually an indefensible result.